brought to you by Penguin.
Loosehead, written and read by me, Joe Marler. For Daisy, Jasper, Maggie and Felix. When the ball is up in the air and it's a perfect kick, it doesn't matter how great it looks because there's no telling which way it's going to bounce when it hits the floor. That's a bit like life, isn't it? You think it's going great 1 minute and all looks wonderful, but you never know which way it's going to take you. Prologue. If I were a horse, you could take me to water and ask me, "Hey, horsey, do you want to have a drink or do you want to swim?" I'm not sure if I'd be a slightly Irish horse or whether I'd just whinny in my own East Sussex accent, but I know I'd reply as quick as a wink. "I want to go out on Saturday, I want to clippity-clop all the way to the stoop, and I want to say hello to the fans." I signed for Harlequins when I was a lardy, wayward 17-year-old, and for 13 years I've lived every rugby boy's dream, winning 71 caps for England, touring with the British and Irish Lions, being called up by the Barbarians and playing in the World Cup final in Japan. It hasn't all been playing clippity-clopping though. For a start, I never set out to be a professional rugby player. My body decided rugby was what I should do long before my head caught up with the idea. My attitude was even later to the party. Much, much later. To tell you the truth, I think it only properly showed up in the last year or so. I haven't taken the most conventional route to the top of my sport, and I'm not the most professional player in the game. Not by a long chalk. I've retired and unretired twice from the England squad, and my charge sheet is eclectic, to say the least. But it takes all sorts, as they say, and how boring life would be if we all trotted along in an orderly fashion, keeping our noses down and never refusing to drink the water. This book is not about putting an egg-shaped ball over the whitewash. It's a rugby tour with a difference, an eye-opening journey through the professional rugby bubble, in and out of my topsy-turvy career, and inside my occasionally loose head. We'll visit my red mohawk and red mist moments. We'll stop off for beers with some of the world's top players and find out why they have names like Sloshbucket, Snorlax and Spidey. And we'll have a peek behind the curtains of the England team hotels and training camps. Along the way, we'll pass through some gates, Fondle Gate and Gypsy Gate, to name a couple of them. We'll drop in for a chat with Eddie Jones and say hello to royalty, celebrities and a wonderful cast of fans that cross our path. We'll also look back at the hard men and amateur era players who blazed the trail for today's modern game, soaking up some history and tradition as we go. If you want to know what goes on when the ref can't see, step this way. We'll unveil the dark arts and smells of the scrum and uncover the naked truths and psychological secrets of playing your best game. There'll be excursions into rugby's inner sanctum, the dope test, the gym, the dressing room and the team meetings. If you dare, have a look beneath the surgical gowns to find out what happens when a player's body goes through the equivalent of 30 car crashes in every game. As for onboard entertainment, I'll tell you what's tickled me, as well as the occasions when I've been the butt of the joke. Quite a few times, as it turns out. There's a catastrophic game of credit card roulette, naked wrestling in the England camp, barbershop disasters in Japan, the curious incident of the tramp on Wellington Harbour, the player who bought a car he couldn't fit his 20 stone arse into. That'll be me. I don't mind a laugh at my expense, but be prepared. We might hit the occasional pothole in the road. Moments when I have a meltdown and press the emergency stop button. We'll deal with those when we get a few miles under our belt. Up and down like a rugby ball, never knowing which way I'll bounce. That's how it goes. I've learned to take the rough with the smooth and count my blessings every day. I'm very lucky to be a professional rugby player. It's taken me to places I could never have imagined, and I've learned so much. Not just about how to be a rugby player, but also about how the whole big rugby bubble bounces along and how to look after yourself when you're in it. It's a privilege to have the chance to share it all. Are you ready to go? Please sit back and enjoy the tour. Chapter 1. Here we go.
Got your kit sorted?
I looked up and saw the bent nose and the huge squash brow. It was Martin Johnson, England's best ever captain, booming down at me from his great height. Intimidating doesn't even begin to cover it. I'd watched him lift in the 2003 World Cup on telly when I was a fat 13-year-old. He was one of the most phenomenal players the country had ever seen. Now here he was, not just standing in front of me, but eyeballing me at the start of my first England training camp in February 2010. "Yes?" I squeaked. "The kit man sorted me out."
"So you're good to go? Good to train, are you?"
I detected an edge to his voice.
"Yeah, I'm good to go."
I was shifting my weight from one foot to the other and mumbling my words. It wasn't the impression I wanted to give to one of rugby's hardest men.
"Well," he barked, "you're going to have to get rid of that fucking stupid air cap before you do."
I blushed. Did Martin Johnson really just say that? Was he serious? I was confused as well as shocked, because what did my air cap have to do with him? With rugby? He stalked off and I glanced around awkwardly, wondering what to do next. The call up to the England squad had come from another rugby legend, Graham Rowntree, aka Wig, then the England scrummaging coach. I'd met him at Harlequins, but I thought it was a mate pissing about when he phoned me out of the blue. "Hi Joe, it's Wig here. Next week, what are you up to?" After an embarrassing altercation during which I declared, "I'm not falling for this, this is a fucking wind-up," I realised it was no joke. Wig told me they had a couple of injured players and he wanted me to train with the squad at Pennyhill Park in Surrey. I'd been playing for Harlequins for a couple of years, but I was still only 19 and not in the best of shape. My imposter syndrome kicked in, massively. How can they want a lardy, lazy teenager like me? What if I balls it up and never get asked again? One thing I hadn't thought about was my haircut. Why would I? Okay, you might get given a nickname like Wig if you had a dodgy flat top like Graham Rowntree. But aside from that, who cared what hairstyle you had? And what did it have to do with Martin Johnson? I was there to play rugby, not be judged on my looks. I could only assume he was showing me who was boss, stamping his authority on a new pup. Besides, how was I supposed to get rid of my new haircut here? I nipped to the toilet before the training session started and caught a glimpse of myself in the mirror. "It'll be fine," I thought. "I'll just have to crack on and hope he doesn't mention it again." My Mohican was dyed the brightest red you could imagine. During the week, I had it trimmed into a very tight, neat stripe. So it looked like I had a giant scarlet-coloured caterpillar sleeping down the middle of my scalp. For a bit of extra pizzazz, I had stars and stripes shaved around the sides of my head. It was an absolutely brilliant haircut, the best I've ever had. There was no way in the world I was getting rid of it, not even for Martin Johnson. I ran out onto the field. "Fuck you, Martin Johnson," I thought. "You can't make me shave my head. My hair's got nothing to do with rugby." Despite my brave thoughts, I still felt like a little kid among so many legends. Johnny Wilkinson, Mike Tyndall and Lee Mears were helping with training. It was surreal. Graham Rowntree spotted me on the sidelines, freezing my nuts off. "Have you not got a gig?" he asked. Yeah, I said, not wanting to admit that I was too scared to go up to Andrew Sheridan, the player I was meant to be swapping in and out with, and say, "Do you mind if I come on now, mate?" Over the years, I've learnt that hair has a lot to do with rugby, one way or another. If I had a time machine, I would go back and say to Martin Johnson, "Look, mate, I know that if I shave my head, things won't go totally doolally, like they did when Samson had a chop. I won't be captured or have my eyes put out, and I won't end up tied to a treadmill for the amusement of the Philistines." Apart from anything else, the gym manager at Pennyhill Park wouldn't have it. But I'm telling you, a rugby player's hair is very, very important to him. Martin Johnson would have laughed in my face. "Son, has that ludicrous caterpillar on your head scrambled your brain?" he'd have replied, I'm guessing. When Martin Johnson started out, rugby was still the amateur era and nobody ever talked about their hair. All the players looked like farmers, solicitors or lorry drivers because that's what they were. Typically, they had no-nonsense short back and sides, classic army corporal crops or skinheads for anyone thinning on the top. Practical, macho haircuts, befitting of gentlemen who were as tough as old boots and played a brutal game. One or two players bucked that trend. Legendary Welsh fullback J.P.R. Williams had flowing hair and magnificent sideburns, but it wasn't a fashion statement. He simply liked long hair and still has long hair today, plus silvery sideburns. Mutton chops of all shapes and sizes weren't unusual back then. and the Welsh boys especially loved a moustache. Paul Ringer had a magnificent Mexican-style tash, and Mervyn Davis, aka Merv the Swerve, was known for pairing his luxuriant black moustache with a white headband. Even so, there was no pre-match preening, not even for the backs, who even then were always better looking than the ugly mugs who stuck their noggin.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.